Hello everyone, and thank you for letting me join. I know you just heard about our great neighbors as well, and I'm here to talk a bit about Copenhagen. We had planned to have a short video before, and I think we'll get it in the end, showcasing Adam, who works today at Playdead, and I think you know that they're unfortunately not at this event, but I think you know there are games inside in Limbo. So welcome to him at the end. I'm not quite as exciting here, but I will try to give you a little bit of insight to Copenhagen. I am Merete, Sandager, and I work at Copenhagen Capacity. And what is Copenhagen Capacity? It's the official organization for investment promotion, and we work to attract international companies and talent to Copenhagen. We are non-for-profit. We are not a recruitment agency. It's maybe a little bit important to say in this area. My focus is to brand Greater Copenhagen and Copenhagen as an attractive career destination towards people like yourself sitting here. So I'm very happy to get this opportunity today. I have been working with the game industry in general in Copenhagen since 2016. And we also work across the border with Southern Sweden with the game industry here as well. Tune in tomorrow where Jesper from will talk much more about the Danish game industry, I think at 9:35 tomorrow morning. So let's see here. So a bit of the cool facts, I'd like to share a bit of the cool facts on why you should move to Copenhagen, a bit about how we can support you if you decide to relocate here and work here, and where you can find, of course, jobs in the game industry besides the companies that are at this event, because of course there are many more companies in Copenhagen as well. But one of the good things is I can let other people talk. Apparently, we have the coolest district in the world. That was interesting. It's just awarded that in October. But actually, I think it has to do with the fact that we're, even though it's a big capital, it feels small with all the small broer we have, Nørrebro, Vesterbro, Østerbro. So of course, it's as a big factor here. But also, if you're a little bit of a foodie, it's also definitely a place to visit. Now you heard Norway and Sweden. We don't have the great big mountains and we don't have the snow, but that's also quite handy when we actually love to bike. So a very flat flat community, or at least the cool part is actually we have more bikes in the city than cars. So if you hate being stuck in commute, you'd love Copenhagen. I think 9 out of 10 actually bike to work. It accounts for almost 50% of all the commute trips that happens. But if you do drive, we have no tolls on the roads. I know they have at least in Oslo. So, but now I did say we didn't have any mountains here, but we do have one, and you can ski all year round. The cool part is it's actually a green energy power station that where you can go and ski on top of that. And that's, of course, a big part of that super ambitious strategy that was made in 2009 to be the first city to be carbon neutral in 2025. So it's a huge focus. That's also why it says a city more than a car city, you can say. And Denmark itself, of course, also aims to be the first country in the world to be entirely fossil free by 2050. So if you're into the green agenda, then also Copenhagen have a lot to offer here as well. And actually since 2005, I think more than 1 billion kroners have been invested in bike lanes and super cycle highways and stuff like that. One of the other things that I'm personally very proud of is, of course, this nomination, because personal freedom is by far very serious in all kinds of areas of society, both outside work, but definitely not inside work. So the possibility to be who you are And we're of course super proud of having Pride in Copenhagen every year, and luckily it was back this year after the pandemic. Safety. I know, of course, the other good Nordic friends have a little bit of the same index here, but so a little bit of bragging, we're on top. But at least for my sake and for the people that are coming further away, it's of course important also to have that aspect in mind when you're moving. For my sake, I love that I can bike at 3 o'clock in the morning after going out and feel totally safe in Copenhagen as a woman as well. And once again, that will be the last of the bragging list. But if you're interested here, you can go into the Monocle's list and check out what are actually they're chosen for this quality of life index. But of course, quality of life is, of course, some of the areas where we like to brand ourselves, because we do believe we have, of course, a high quality of life in general. But other good reasons to choose Copenhagen is, of course, that we do speak other than Danish, which is, I think, very good, since Danish is a very small language. We're only 5.7 million people. So there's not much you can use Danish for. So the rest of the 14% are either babies or seniors, so don't worry about them. You'll find plenty that can speak English. And there's also, of course, a huge international society, or huge and huge, but a rather large international society working in the capital region as well. One of the things that are better in Copenhagen than Stockholm or Oslo is that we are very close to the airport. So if you need to go home or go fly somewhere, it's only 15 minutes away from the city center. And then, of course, the healthcare part, super important to mention. Everything is of course, free. Also, individual visits to your personal doctor. The childcare is heavily subsidized. So at least I got a shock when I realized that in Boston it cost $25,000 to have your kid in kindergarten every year. So that's by far a good thing here. And if you do want to do a little bit more hygge in Danish, we have free Danish classes, so you can take it, your spouse can take it, etc. And of course also there's free education. So if you come with the kids, they can go to school, they can go to high school, to university for free as well, if you're here. We have quite a lot of international schools in Copenhagen, in the Copenhagen region. So there's one public school that's totally free, but the rest are private schools. And they do, of course, have a fee, but I think you'd find a reasonable fee, definitely, compared to other places in the world. Now we're to the part where, my light went out. Now we're at the part where, what can we actually help you with when you come to Copenhagen? We have the International House in Copenhagen, which is the welcome center for all international who move here. And the services you can hear is, of course, all the bureaucratic the bureaucratic stuff. You can actually have settled here in one place. So like it's one point entry. There are some different welcome and retention activities. You can get some inspiration about job and career. We have some different programs. And if you want to be a volunteer and get a great network here of other internationals and Danes, there's also a lot of civic participation you can join into. But back to the authority path, the more bureaucratic stuff. So here's one place that you can actually go get your social security number, you get your health insurance, your health tax card, bank account, all of that, choosing the doctor. Also, if you're an EU citizen, get your work permit here. If you need to re-register, etc. There's all the job and career part here. There are three programs here, and one is specifically for spouses. So I think that's important to mention as well, that that you would actually have some opportunities here. It's free of charge. There's also something called First Job in Copenhagen, which is a week program with all the basics, like how should a CV look, and where should you how should you kind of go about in being a looking for a job in Copenhagen? There's also a lot of events more to the welcoming and integration. So I think a lot of the more complex stuff when you live here is actually, yeah, banking, security, the tax system. If you need to go in and look at your tax bill, how do I read my tax bill? If I want to buy a house, an apartment, what should I go about and how should I behave? There's also a lot of more culture-wise activity they make as well, to get some insight into network and leisure guide and stuff like that. Very important also, I need to speak fast, I have 4 minutes left, where to find the jobs. Of course, as mentioned, there are plenty of other companies and game studios in Copenhagen, and actually also Southern Sweden that you'd be able to find on this career portal. Here you can say at the moment, there's almost 200 open jobs that you can go and check out, specifically within the game studios. You should go to sign up also, if you want us to be able to find you, sign up for the talent pool within the game area. Because this way we'd always be able to reach out to you if we have any specific events or specific activities, especially for the game studios in Copenhagen. I just wanted to also to share a couple of relevant links. Life in Copenhagen or Life in Denmark, where you can find almost all information you need. Ny I Danmark, New to Denmark, is the more official part from the authority side, which is more specifically how to apply, what should be you make sure to have available, what kind of papers and what does it take, how long does it take, what does it cost. So, and then the two below links are the also for the International House, where you can get much more information. And just again, briefly mentioning, Jesper will be talking more about the game industry overview tomorrow. And I think Oleg is after me now. I have one left. And this is more for the foodies, if you like beer or wine or other things. Then there are plenty of things to come about.
Thank you. Thank you, Merete, for an excellent presentation. And